Gabriel Conroy. By Bret Harte. Podcast 12 of 16. Book 6. A Dip. Chapter 4. M.R. Hamlin is off with an old love. Mr. Jack Hamlin did not lose much time on the road from Wingdam to Sacramento. His rapid driving, his dust-bespattered vehicle, and the exhausted condition of his horse on arrival, excited but little comment from those who knew his habits, and for other criticism he had a supreme indifference. He was prudent enough, however, to leave his horse at a stable on the outskirts, and having reconstructed his toilet at a neighboring hotel, he walked briskly toward the address given him by Maxwell. When he reached the corner of the street and was within a few paces of the massive shining doorplate of Madame Eclair's pensionnat, he stopped with a sudden ejaculation, and after a moment's hesitation, turned on his heel deliberately and began to retrace his steps. To explain Mr. Hamlin's singular conduct, I shall be obliged to disclose a secret of his, which I would fain keep from the fair reader. On receiving Ollie's address from Maxwell, Mr. Hamlin had only cursorily glanced at it, and it was only on arriving before the house that he recognized to his horror that it was a boarding school, with one of whose impulsive inmates he had whiled away his idleness a few months before in a heartbreaking but innocent flirtation, and a soul-subduing but clandestine correspondence, much to the distaste of the correct principal. To have presented himself there in his proper person would be to have been refused admittance or subjected to a suspicion that would have kept Ollie from his hands. For once, Mr. Hamlin severely regretted his infelix reputation among the sex. But he did not turn his back on his enterprise. He retraced his steps only to the main street, visited a barber's shop and a jeweler's, and reappeared on the street again with a pair of enormous green goggles and all traces of his long distinguishing silken black mustache shaven from his lip. When it is remembered that this rascal was somewhat vain of his personal appearance, the reader will appreciate his earnestness and the extent of his sacrifice. Nevertheless, he was a little nervous as he was ushered into the formal reception room of the pensionnat, and waited until his credentials, countersigned by Maxwell, were submitted to Madame Eclair. Mr. Hamlin had no fear of being detected by his real name. In the brief halcyon days of his romance he had been known as Clarence Spifflington, an ingenious combination of the sentimental and humorous which suited his fancy, and to some extent he felt expressed the character of his affection. Fate was propitious, the servant returned saying that Miss Conroy would be down in a moment, and Mr. Hamlin looked at his watch. Every moment was precious. He was beginning to get impatient when the door opened again and Ollie slipped into the room. She was a pretty child, with a peculiar boyish frankness of glance and manner, and a refinement of feature that fascinated Mr. Hamlin, who, fond as he was of all childhood, had certain masculine preferences for good looks. She seemed to be struggling with a desire to laugh when she entered, and when Jack turned towards her with extended hands she held up her own warningly, and closing the door behind her cautiously, said, in a demure whisper, "She'll come down as soon as she can slip past Madame's door." "Who?" asked Jack.
"Sophie."
"Who's Sophie?" asked Jack, seriously. He had never known the name of his Dulcinea. In the dim epistolatory region of sentiment she had existed only as the Blue Moselle, so called from the cerulean hue of her favorite raiment, and occasionally, in moments of familiar endearment, as Mosey. "Come, now, pretend you don't know, will you?" said Ollie, evading the kiss which Jack always had ready for childhood. "If I was her, I wouldn't have anything to say to you after that," she added, with that ostentatious chivalry of the sex towards each other, in the presence of their common enemy. "Why, she saw you from the window when you first came this morning. When you went back again and shaved off your mustache, she knew you. And you don't know her. It's mean, ain't it? They'll grow again, won't they?" Miss Ollie referred to the mustachios and not the affections. Jack was astonished and alarmed. In his anxiety to evade or placate the duenna, he had never thought of her charge his sweetheart. Here was a dilemma. "Oh yes," said Jack hastily, with a well-simulated expression of arch affection, "Sophie, of course that's my little game. But I've got a note for you too, my dear," and he handed Ollie the few lines that Gabriel had hastily scrawled. He watched her keenly, almost breathlessly, as she read them. To his utter bewilderment, she laid the note down indifferently and said, "That's like Gabe the old simpleton. But you're going to do what he says," asked Mr. Hamlin, "ain't you?"
"No," said Ollie, promptly, "I ain't."
"Why, Lord Mr. Hamlin, you don't know that man. Why, he does this sort o' thing every week." Perceiving Jack's stare, she went on, "Why, only last week, didn't he send to me to meet him out on the corner of the street, and he my own brother, instead o' come in here, easy he easy a right to do. Go to him at Wingdam?
No.
Catch me." "But suppose he can't come," continued Mr. Hamlin.
"Why can't he come?"
"I tell you, it's just foolishness and the meanest kind o' bashfulness. Just because there happened to be a young lady here from San Francisco, Rosie Ringround, who was a little took with the old fool. If he could come to Wingdam, why couldn't he come here? That's what I want to know."
"Will you let me see that note?" asked Hamlin.
Ollie handed him the note, with the remark, "He don't spell well and he won't let me teach him the old muggins." Hamlin took it and read as follows. "Dear Ollie, if it don't run afoul of your lessings and the madam's willin and the young laddies, brother Gab's waitin' for ye at Wingdam, so no more from your affectionate brother, Gab." Mr. Hamlin was in a quandary. It never had been part of his plan to let Ollie know the importance of her journey. Mr. Maxwell's injunctions to bring her quietly, his own fears of an outburst that might bring a questioning and sympathetic school about his ears, and lastly, and not the least potently, his own desire to enjoy Ollie's company in the long ride to One Horse Gulch without the preoccupation of grief, with his own comfortable conviction that he could eventually bring Gabriel out of this fix without Ollie knowing anything about it, all this forbade his telling her the truth. But here was a coil he had not thought of. Howbeit, Mr. Hamlin was quick at expedients. "Then you think Sophie can see me?" he added, with a sudden interest.
"Of course she will," said Ollie, archly.
"It was right smart in you to get acquainted with Gabe and set him up to writing that, though it's just like him. He's that soft that anybody could get round him. But there she is now, Mr. Hamlin, that's her step on the stairs. And I don't suppose you two has any need of me now." And she slipped out of the room, as demurely as she had entered, at the same moment that a tall, slim, and somewhat sensational young lady in blue came flying in. I can, in justice to Mr. Hamlin, whose secrets have been perhaps needlessly violated in the progress of this story, do no less than pass over as sacred, and perhaps wholly irrelevant to the issue, the interview that took place between himself and Miss Sophie. That he succeeded in convincing that young woman of his unaltered loyalty, that he explained his long silence as the result of a torturing doubt of the permanence of her own affection, that his presence at that moment was the successful culmination of a long-matured and desperate plan to see her once more and learn the truth from her own lips, I am sure that no member of my own disgraceful sex will question, and I trust no member of a too fond and confiding sex will doubt. That some bitterness was felt by Mr. Hamlin, who was conscious of certain irregularities during this long interval, and some tears shed by Miss Sophie, who was equally conscious of more or less aberration of her own magnetic instincts during his absence, I think will be self-evident to the largely comprehending reader. Howbeit, at the end of 10 tender yet tranquil leisuring minutes, Mr. Hamlin remarked, in low thrilling tones, "By the aid of a few confiding friends, and playing it rather low on them, I got that note to the Conroy girl, but the game's up, and we might as well pass in our checks now, if she goes back on us, and passes out, which I reckon's her little game. If what you say is true, Sophie, and you do sometimes look back to the past, and things is generally on the square, you'll go for that Ollie and fetch her, for if I go back without that child, and throw up my hand, it's just tampering with the holiest affections and playing it mighty rough on as white a man as ever you saw, Sophie, to say nothing of your reputation, and everybody ready to buck agin us who has 10 cents to chip in on. You must make her go back with me and put things on a specie basis.
In spite of the mixed character of Mr. Hamlin's metaphor, his eloquence was so convincing and effective that Miss Sophie at once proceeded with considerable indignation to insist upon Ollie's withdrawing her refusal. "If this is the way you are going to act, you horrid little thing, after all that me and him's trusted you, I'd like to see the girl in school that will ever tell you anything again, that's all," a threat so appalling that Ollie, who did not stop to consider that this confidence was very recent and had been forced upon her, assented without further delay, exhibited Gabriel's letter to Madame Eclair, and having received that lady's gracious permission to visit her brother, was in half an hour in company with Mr. Hamlin on the road. Chapter 5. The Three Voices. Once free from the trammeling fascinations of Sophie and the more dangerous espionage of Madame Eclair, and with the object of his mission accomplished, Mr. Hamlin recovered his natural spirits, and became so hilarious that Ollie, who attributed this exaltation to his interview with Sophie, felt constrained to make some disparaging remarks about that young lady, partly by way of getting even with her for her recent interference, and partly in obedience to some well-known but unexplained law of the sex. To her great surprise, however, Mr. Hamlin's spirits were in no way damped, nor did he make any attempt to defend his lalage. Nevertheless, he listened attentively, and when she had concluded he looked suddenly down upon her chip hat and thick yellow tresses, and said, "Ever been in the southern country, Ollie?" "No," returned the child. "Never down about San Antonio, visiting friends or relations?" "No," said Ollie, decidedly. Mr. Hamlin was silent for some time, giving his exclusive attention to his horse, who was evincing a disposition to break into a gallop. When he had brought the animal back into a trot again, he continued, "There's a woman, Ollie." "Down in San Antonio?" asked Ollie. Mr. Hamlin nodded. "Pretty," continued the child. "It ain't the word," responded Mr. Hamlin, seriously. "Pretty ain't the word." "As pretty as Sophie," continued Ollie, a little mischievously. "Sophie be hanged." Mr. Hamlin here quickly pulled up himself and horse, both being inclined to an exuberance startling to the youth and sex of the third party. "That is, I mean something in a different suit entirely." Here he again hesitated, doubtful of his slang. "I see," quoth Ollie, "diamond Sophie's in spades." The gambler, in sudden and awful admiration, "Diamonds, you've just struck it, but what do you know about cards?" Ollie, pomposement, "Everything. Tell our fortunes by em we girls." "I'm in hearts, Sophie's in spades, you're in clubs. Do you know," in a thrilling whisper, "only last night I had a letter, a journey, a death, and a gentleman in clubs, dark complect, that's you." Mr. Hamlin a good deal more at ease through this revelation of the universal power of the four suits. "Speaking of women, I suppose down there," indicating the school, "you occasionally hear of angels. What's their general complexion?" Ollie, dubiously, "In the pictures." Hamlin, "Yes," with a leading question, "sorter dark complex sometimes, hey." Ollie, positively, "Never, always white." Jack, "Always white." Ollie, "Yes, and flabby." They rode along for some time silently. Presently Mr. Hamlin broke into a song, a popular song, one verse of which Ollie supplied with such deftness of execution and melodiousness of pipe that Mr. Hamlin instantly suggested a duet, and so over the dead and barren wastes of the Sacramento plains they fell to singing, often barbarously, sometimes melodiously, but never self-consciously, wherein, I take it, they approximated to the birds and better class of poets, so that rough teamsters, rude packers, and weary wayfarers were often touched, as with the birds and poets aforesaid, to admiration and tenderness, and when they stopped for supper at a wayside station, and Jack Hamlin displayed that readiness of resource, audacity of manner and address, and perfect and natural obliviousness to the criticism of propriety or the limitations of precedent, and when, moreover, the results of all this was a much better supper than perhaps a more reputable companion could have procured, She thought she had never known a more engaging person than this knave of clubs. When they were fairly on the road again, Ollie began to exhibit some curiosity regarding her brother, and asked some few questions about Gabriel's family, which disclosed the fact that Jack's acquaintance with Gabriel was comparatively recent. "Then you never saw July at all?" asked Ollie. "July?" queried Jack, reflectively. "What's she like?"
"I don't know whether she's a heart or a spade," said Ollie, as thoughtfully.
Jack was silent for some moments, and then after a pause, to Ollie's intense astonishment, proceeded to sketch, in a few vigorous phrases, the external characteristics of Mrs. Conroy.
"Why, you said you never saw her," ejaculated Ollie.
"No more I did," responded the gambler, with a quick laugh. "This is only a little bluff." It had grown cold with the brief twilight and the coming on of night. For some time the black, unchanging outlines of the distant coast range were sharply silhouetted against a pale, ashen sky, that at last faded utterly, leaving a few stars behind as emblems of the burnt-out sunset. The red road presently lost its calm and even outline in the swiftly gathering shadows, or to Ollie's fancy was stopped by shapeless masses of rock or giant-like trunks of trees that in turn seemed to give way before the skillful hand and persistent will of her driver. At times a chill exhalation from a roadside ditch came to Ollie like the damp breath of an open grave, and the child shivered even beneath the thick traveling shawl of Mr. Hamlin, with which she was enwrapped. Whereat Jack at once produced a flask and prevailed upon Ollie to drink something that set her coughing, but which that astute and experienced child at once recognized as whiskey. Mr. Hamlin, to her surprise, however, did not himself partake, a fact which she at once pointed out to him. "At an early age, Ollie," said Mr. Hamlin, with infinite gravity, "I promised an infirm and aged relative never to indulge in spirit-use liquors, except on a physician's prescription. I carry this flask subject to the doctor's orders. Never having ordered me to drink any, I don't." As it was too dark for the child to observe Mr. Hamlin's eyes, which, after the fashion of her sex, she consulted much oftener than his speech for his real meaning, and was as often deceived, she said nothing, and Mr. Hamlin relapsed into silence. At the end of 5 minutes he said, "She was a woman, Ollie, you bet." Ollie, with great tact and discernment, instantly referring back to Mr. Hamlin's discourse of an hour before, queried, "That girl in the southern country?"
"Yes," said Mr. Hamlin.
"Tell me all about her," said Ollie, "all you know."
"That ain't much," mused Hamlin, with a slight sigh.
"Ah, Ollie, she could sing."
"With the piano," said Ollie, a little superciliously.
"With the organ," said Hamlin. Ollie, whose sole idea of this instrument was of the itinerant barrel variety, yawned slightly, and with a very perceptible lack of interest said that she hoped she would see her sometime when she came up that way and was going round. Mr. Hamlin did not laugh, but after a few minutes' rapid driving, began to explain to Ollie with great earnestness the character of a church organ. "I used to play once, Ollie, in a church. They did say that I used sometimes to fetch that congregation, jest snatch em bald-headed, Ollie, but it's a long time ago. There was one hymn in particular that I used to run on can see drabble one o' them masses o' Mozart one that I heard her sing, Ollie, it went something like this," and Jack proceeded to lift his voice in the praise of Our Lady of Sorrows, with a serene unconsciousness to his surroundings, and utter absorption in his theme that would have become the most enthusiastic acolyte. The springs creaked, the wheels rattled, the mare broke, plunged, and recovered herself, the slight vehicle swayed from side to side, Ollie's hat bruised and flattened itself against his shoulder, and still Mr. Hamlin sang. When he had finished he looked down at Ollie. She was asleep. Jack was an artist and an enthusiast, but not unreasonable nor unforgiving. "It's the whiskey," he murmured to himself, in an apologetic recitation to the air he had just been singing. He changed the reins to his other hand with infinite caution and gentleness, slowly passed his disengaged arm round the swaying little figure, until he had drawn the chip hat and the golden tresses down upon his breast and shoulder.
In this attitude, scarcely moving a muscle lest he should waken the sleeping child, at midnight he came upon the twinkling lights of Fiddletown. Here he procured a fresh horse, dispensing with an ostler and harnessing the animal himself, with such noiseless skill and quickness that Ollie, propped up in the buggy with pillows and blankets borrowed from the Fiddletown hostelry, slept through it all, nor wakened even after they were again upon the road, and had begun the long ascent of the Wingdam Turnpike. It wanted but an hour of daybreak when he reached the summit, and even then he only slackened his pace when his wheels sank to their hubs in the beaten dust of the stage road. The darkness of that early hour was intensified by the gloom of the heavy pine woods through which the red road threaded its difficult and devious way. It was very still. Hamlin could hardly hear the dead, muffled plunge of his own horse in the dusty track before him, and yet once or twice he stopped to listen. His quick ear detected the sound of voices and the jingle of Mexican spurs, apparently approaching behind him. Mr. Hamlin knew that he had not passed any horsemen and was for a moment puzzled. But then he recalled the fact that a few hundred yards beyond, the road was intersected by the cut off to One Horse Gulch, which, after running parallel with the Wingdam Turnpike for half a mile, crossed it in the forest. The voices were on that road going the same way. Mr. Hamlin pushed on his horse to the crossing, and hidden by the darkness and the trunks of the giant pines, pulled up to let the strangers precede him. In a few moments the voices were abreast of him and stationary. The horsemen had apparently halted. "Here seems to be a road," said a voice quite audibly. "All right, then," returned another, "it's the cut-off. We'll save an hour, sure." A third voice here struck in potentially, "Keep the stage road. If Joe Hall gets wind of what's up, he'll run his man down to Sacramento for safekeeping. If he does, he'll take this road. It's the only one, Sabe, we can't miss him." Jack Hamlin leaned forward breathlessly in his seat. "But it's an hour longer this way," growled the second voice. "The boys will wait," responded the previous speaker. There was a laugh, a jingling of spurs, and the invisible procession moved slowly forward in the darkness. Mr. Hamlin did not stir a muscle until the voices failed before him in the distance. Then he cast a quick glance at the child. She still slept quietly, undisturbed by the halt or those ominous voices which had brought so sudden a color into her companion's cheek and so baleful a light in his dark eyes. Yet for a moment Mr. Hamlin hesitated. To go forward to Wingdam now would necessitate his following cautiously in the rear of the lynchers, and so prevent his giving a timely alarm. To strike across to One Horse Gulch by the cut-off would lose him the chance of meeting the sheriff and his prisoner, had they been forewarned and were escaping in time. But for the impediment of the unconscious little figure beside him, he would have risked a dash through the party ahead of him. But that was not to be thought of now. He must follow them to Wingdam, leave the child, and trust to luck to reach One Horse Gulch before them. If they delayed a moment at Wingdam, it could be done. A feeling of yearning tenderness and pity succeeded the slight impatience with which he had a moment before regarded his encumbering charge. He held her in his arms, scarcely daring to breathe lest he should waken her, hoping that she might sleep until they reached Wingdam, and that leaving her with his faithful henchman Pete, he might get away before she was aroused to embarrassing inquiry. Mr. Hamlin had a man's dread of scenes with even so small a specimen of the sex, and for once in his life he felt doubtful of his own readiness, and feared lest in his excitement he might reveal the imminent danger of her brother. Perhaps he was never before so conscious of that danger. Perhaps he was never before so interested in the life of anyone. He began to see things with Ollie's eyes, to look upon events with reference to her feelings rather than his own. If she had sobbed and cried, this sympathetic rascal really believed that he would have cried too. Such was the unconscious and sincere flattery of admiration. He was relieved, when with the first streaks of dawn, his mare wearily clattered over the scattered river pebbles and tailings that paved the outskirts of Wingdam. He was still more relieved when the three voices of the night, now faintly visible as three armed horsemen, drew up before the veranda of the Wingdam Hotel, dismounted, and passed into the bar room. And he was perfectly content, when a moment later he lifted the still sleeping Ollie in his arms and bore her swiftly yet cautiously to his room. To awaken the sleeping Pete on the floor above, and drag him half-dressed and bewildered into the presence of the unconscious child, as she lay on Jack Hamlin's own bed, half-buried in a heap of shawls and rugs, was only the work of another moment.
"Why, Mars Jack!
Bress de Lord, it's a chilly," said Pete, recoiling in sacred awe and astonishment.
"Hold your jaw," said Jack, in a fierce whisper, "you'll waken her.
Listen to me, you chattering idiot. Don't waken her, if you want to keep the bones in your creaking old skeleton whole enough for the doctors to buy. Let her sleep as long as she can. If she wakes up and asks after me, tell her I'm gone for her brother. Do you hear? Give her anything she asks for except the truth.
What are you doing, you old fool?"
Pete was carefully removing the mountain of shawls and blankets that Jack had piled upon Ollie.
"For God, Mars Jack, you smuttering dad chilly," was his only response.
Nevertheless, Jack was satisfied with a certain vague tenderness in his manipulation, and said curtly, "Get me a horse."
"It ain't to be did, Mars Jack, de stables is all gone cleaned.
Day's a rush over to One Horse Gulch, all day.
There are three horses at the door," said Jack, with wicked significance.
"For de love of God, Mars Jack, don't ye do dat," ejaculated Pete, in unfeigned and tremulous alarm.
"Dey don't take dem kind o' jokes, you're worth a cent, dey'd be doin' some of an awful to ye, Sashua as you're born."
But Jack, with the child lying there peaceably in his own bed, and the three voices growing husky in the bar room below, regained all his old audacity.
"I haven't made up my mind," continued Jack, coolly, "which of the three I'll take, but you'll find out from the owner when I do.
Tell him that Mr. Jack Hamlin left his compliments and a mare and buggy for him. You can say that if he keeps the mare from breaking and gives her her head downhill, she can do her mile inside of 2.45.
Hush!
Not a word.
Bye-bye."
He turned, lifted the shawl from the fresh cheek of the sleeping Ollie, kissed her, and shaking his fist at Pete, vanished. For a few moments the Negro listened breathlessly. And then there came the sharp, quick clatter of hoofs from the rocky road below, and he sank dejectedly at the foot of the bed.
"He's gone done it.
Lord save us.
But it's a hangin' matter, yer."
And even as he spoke, Mr. Jack Hamlin, mounted on the fleet Mustang that had been ridden by the potential voice, with his audacious face against the red sunrise and his right shoulder squarely advanced, was butting away the morning mists that rolled slowly along the river road to One Horse Gulch.
Chapter 6. Mr. Dumphy is perplexed by a movement in real estate. Mr. Dumphy's confidence in himself was so greatly restored that several business enterprises of great pith and moment, whose currents for the past few days had been turned awry, and so lost the name of action, were taken up by him with great vigor and corresponding joy to the humbler business associates who had asked him just to lend his name to that project, and make a big thing of it. He had just given his royal sanction and a check to an association for the encouragement of immigration, by the distribution through the sister states of 1,000,000 seductive pamphlets, setting forth the various resources and advantages of California for the farmer, and proving that $150 spent for a passage thither was equal to the price of a farm. He had also assisted in sending the eloquent Mr. Blowhard and the persuasive Mr. Windy Gust to present these facts orally to the benighted dwellers of the East, and had secured the services of two eminent Californian statisticians to demonstrate the fact that more people were killed by lightning and frozen to death in the streets of New York in a single year than were ever killed by railroad accidents or human violence in California during the past three centuries. He had that day conceived the truly magnificent plan of bringing the waters of Lake Tahoe to San Francisco by ditches, thereby enabling the citizens to keep the turf in their dooryards green through the summer. He had started two banks, a stage line, and a watering place, whose climate and springs were declared healthful by edict, and were aggressively advertised, and he had just projected a small suburban town that should bear his name.
He had returned from this place in high spirits with a company of friends in the morning after this interview with Poinsett. There was certainly no trace of the depression of that day in his manner. It was a foggy morning, following a clear, still night, an atmospheric condition not unusual at that season of the year to attract Mr. Dumphy's attention, yet he was conscious on reaching his office of an undue oppressiveness in the air that indisposed him to exertion, and caused him to remove his coat and cravat. Then he fell to work upon his morning's mail, and speedily forgot the weather. There was a letter from Mrs. Sepulveda, disclosing the fact that, owing to the sudden and unaccountable drying up of the springs on the lower plains, large numbers of her cattle had died of thirst and were still perishing. This was of serious import to Mr. Dumphy, who had advanced money on this perishable stock, and he instantly made a memorandum to check this sudden freak of nature, which he at once attributed to feminine carelessness of management. Further on, Mrs. Sepulveda inquired particularly as to the condition of the Conroy mine, and displayed a disposition characteristic of her sex, to realize at once on her investment. Her letter ended thus, "But I shall probably see you in San Francisco. Pepe says that this morning the markings on the beach showed the rise of a tide or wave during the night higher than any ever known since 1800. I do not feel safe so near the beach, and shall rebuild in the spring." Mr. Dumphy smiled grimly to himself. He had at one time envied Poinsett. But here was the woman he was engaged to marry, careless, improvident, with a vast estate, and on the eve of financial disaster through her carelessness, and yet actually about to take a journey of 200 miles because of some foolish, womanish whim or superstition. It would be a fine thing if this man, to whom good fortune fell without any effort on his part, this easy, elegant, supercilious Arthur Poinsett, who was even indifferent to that good fortune, should find himself tricked and deceived. Should have to apply to him, Dumphy, for advice and assistance. And this, too, after his own advice and assistance regarding the claims of Colonel Starbottle's client had been futile. The revenge would be complete. Mr. Dumphy rubbed his hands in prospective satisfaction. When, a few moments later, Colonel Starbottle's card was put into his hand, Mr. Dumphy's satisfaction was complete. This was the day that the gallant colonel was to call for an answer. It was evident that Arthur had not seen him, nor had he made the discovery of Starbottle's unknown client. The opportunity of vanquishing this man without the aid or even knowledge of Poinsett was now before him. By way of preparing himself for the encounter, as well as punishing the colonel, he purposely delayed the interview, and for full 5 minutes kept his visitor cooling his heels in the outer office. He was seated at his desk, ostentatiously preoccupied, when Colonel Starbottle was at last admitted. He did not raise his head when the door opened, nor in fact until the colonel, stepping lightly forward, walked to Dumphy's side, and deliberately unhooking his cane from its accustomed rest on his arm, laid it, pronouncedly, on the desk before him. The colonel's face was empurpled, the colonel's chest was efflorescent and bursting, the colonel had the general effect of being about to boil over the top button of his coat, but his manner was jauntily and daintily precise. "One moment, a single moment, sir," he said, with husky politeness. "Before proceeding to business, we will devote a single moment to the necessary explanations of a gentleman. The card now lying before you, sir, was handed 10 minutes ago to one of your subordinates. I wish to inquire, sir, if it was then delivered to you." "Yes," said Mr. Dumphy, impatiently. Colonel Starbottle leaned over Mr. Dumphy's desk and coolly rung his bell. Mr. Dumphy's clerk instantly appeared at the door. "I wish," said the colonel, addressing himself to the astounded employee as he stood loftily over Mr. Dumphy's chair, "I have in fact sent for you, to withdraw the offensive epithets I addressed to you, and the threats of personal violence. The offense is not yours but rests with your employer, for whose apology I am now waiting. Nevertheless, I am ready, sir, to hold myself at your service, that is of course after my responsibility with your master ceases." Mr. Dumphy, who in the presence of Colonel Starbottle felt his former awkwardness return, signed with a forced smile to his embarrassed clerk to withdraw, and said hastily, but with an assumption of easy familiarity, "Sorry, Colonel, sorry, but I was very busy, and am now. No offense. All a mistake, you know. Businessman and business hours," and Mr. Dumphy leaned back in his chair, and emitted his rare cacinatory bark.
"Glad to hear it, sir, I accept your apology," said the Colonel, recovering his good humor and his profanity together. "Hang me, if I didn't think it was another affair like that I had with old Mitch Tolliver, of Georgia. Called on him in Washington in 48 during session. Boy took up my card. Waited 10 minutes, no reply. Then sent friend, poor Jeff Boomerang, dead now, killed in New Orleans by Ben Pastor with challenge. Hang me, sir, after the second shot, Mitch sends for me, lying there with hole in both lungs, gasping for breath. It's all a blunder, Star, he says, boy never brought Kyard. Horsewhip the racial expletive for me, Star, for I reckon I won't live to do it, and died like a gentleman, blank me. What have you got to propose?" said Mr. Dumphy, hastily, seeing an opportunity to stop the flow of the Colonel's recollections. "According to my memory, at our last interview over the social glass in your own house, I think something was said of a proposition coming from you." "That is er," continued the Colonel, loftily, "I hold myself responsible for the mistake, if any." It had been Mr. Dumphy's first intention to assume the roughly offensive, to curtly inform Colonel Starbottle of the flight of his confederate, and dare him to do his worst. But for certain vague reasons he changed his plan of tactics. He drew his chair closer to the Colonel, and clapping his hand familiarly on his shoulder, began. "You're a man of the world, Starbottle, so am I, Sabe. You're a gentleman, so am I," he continued, hastily. "But I'm a businessman, and you're not. Sabe. Let's understand each other. No offense, you know, but in the way of business. This woman, claiming to be my wife, don't exist. It's all right, you know, I understand. I don't blame you, but you've been deceived, and all that sort of thing. I've got the proofs. Now as a man of the world and a gentleman and a businessman, when I say the game's up, you'll understand me. Look at that there." He thrust into Starbottle's hand the telegram of the preceding day. "There, the man's hung by this time lynched. The woman's gone." Colonel Starbottle read the telegram without any perceptible dismay or astonishment. "Conroy. Conroy, don't know the man. There was a McConroy, of St. Joe, but I don't think it's the same. No, sir. This ain't like him, sir. Don't seem to be a duel, unless he'd posted the man to kill on sight. Murder's an ugly word to use to gentlemen. D.D. me, sir, I don't know but he could hold the man responsible who sent that dispatch. It's offensive, sir, very. And you don't know Mrs. Conroy," continued Mr. Dumphy, fixing his eyes on Colonel Starbottle's face. "Mrs. Conroy. The wife of the superintendent, one of the most beautiful women. Good gad, sir, I do. And I'm devilish sorry for her. But what's this got to do with our affair?" "Oh. I see, gad." The Colonel suddenly chuckled, drew out his handkerchief, and waved it in the air with deprecatory gallantry. "Gossip, sir, all gossip. People will talk. A fine woman. Blank me, if she was inclined to show some attention to Colonel Starbottle, gad, sir, it was no more than other women have. You comprehend, Dumphy? Gad, sir, so the story's got round, eh, husband's jealous killed wrong man. Folks think she's run off with Colonel Starbottle, ha. Ha. No, sir," he continued, suddenly dropping into an attitude of dignified severity. "You can say that Colonel Starbottle branded the story as a lie, sir. That whatever might have been the foolish indiscretion of a susceptible sex, Colonel Starbottle will defend the reputation of that lady, sir, with his life, with his life.
Absurd and ridiculous as the sudden diversion of Colonel Starbottle from the point at issue had become, Dumphy could not doubt his sincerity, nor the now self-evident fact that Mrs. Conroy was not his visitor's mysterious client. Mr. Dumphy felt that his suddenly built-up theory was demolished and his hope with it. He was still at the mercy of this conceited braggart and the invisible power behind him, whoever or whatever it might be. Mr. Dumphy was not inclined to superstition, but he began to experience a strange awe of his unknown persecutor, and resolved at any risk to discover who it was. Could it be really his wife? Had not the supercilious Poinsett been himself tricked, or was he not now trying to trick him, Dumphy? Couldn't Starbottle be bribed to expose at least the name of his client? He would try it. I said just now you had been deceived in this woman who represents herself to be my wife. I find I have been mistaken in the person, who I believe imposed upon you, and it is possible that I may be otherwise wrong. My wife may be alive. I am willing to admit it. Bring her here tomorrow and I will accept it as a fact. You forget that she refuses to see you again, said Colonel Starbottle, until she has established her claim by process of law. That's so, that's all right, old fellow, we understand each other. Now, suppose that we businessmen, as a business maxim, you know, always prefer to deal with principals. Now suppose we even go so far as to do that and yet pay an agent's commission, perhaps you understand me, even a bonus. Good. That's business. You understand that as a gentleman and a man of the world. Now, I say, bring me your principal, fetch along that woman, and I'll make it all right with you. Stop. I know what you're going to say, you're bound by honor and all that, I understand your position as a gentleman, and respect it. Then let me know where I can find her. Understand, you shan't be compromised as bringing about the interview in any way. I'll see that you're protected in your commissions from your client, and for my part, if a check for $5,000 will satisfy you of my desire to do the right thing in this matter, it's at your service. The colonel rose to his feet and applied himself apparently to the single and silent inflation of his chest, for the space of a minute. When the upper buttons of his coat seemed to be on the point of flying off with the report, he suddenly extended his hand and grasped Dumphy's with fervour. Permit me, he said, in a voice husky with emotion, to congratulate myself on dealing with a gentleman and a man of honour. Your sentiments, sir, I don't care if I do say it, do you credit. I am proud, sir, continued the colonel, warmly, to have made your acquaintance. But I regret to say, sir, that I cannot give you the information you require. I do not myself know the name or address of my client. The look of half-contemptuous satisfaction which had irradiated Dumphy's face at the beginning of this speech, changed to one of angry suspicion at its close. That's a DD queer oversight of yours, he ejaculated, with an expression as nearly insulting as he dared to make it. Colonel Starbottle did not apparently notice the manner of his speech, but drawing his chair close beside Dumphy, he laid his hand upon his arm. Your confidence as a man of honor and a gentleman, he began, demands equal confidence and frankness on my part, and culp. Starbottle of Virginia is not the man to withhold it. When I state that I do not know the name and address of my client, I believe, sir, there is no one now living, who will require or deem it necessary for me to repeat the assertion. Certainly not, sir, added the colonel, lightly waving his hand. The gentleman who has just honored me with his confidence and invited mine, I thank you, sir, he continued, as Mr. Dumphy made a hasty motion of assent, and will go on. It is not necessary for me to name the party who first put me in possession of the facts. You will take my word as a gentleman that it is someone unknown to you, of unimportant position, though of strict respectability, and one who acted only as the agent of my real client. When the case was handed over to me, there was also put into my possession a sealed envelope containing the name of my client and principal witness. My injunctions were not to open it until all negotiations had failed and it was necessary to institute legal proceedings. That envelope I have here. You perceive it is unopened. Mr. Dumphy unconsciously reached out his hand. With a gesture of polite deprecation, Colonel Starbottle evaded it, and placing the letter on the table before him, continued, "It is unnecessary to say that there being in my judgment no immediate necessity for the beginning of a suit, the injunctions still restrain me, and I shall not open the letter. If, however, I accidentally mislay it on this table and it is returned to me tomorrow, sealed as before, I believe, sir, as a gentleman and a man of honor, I violate no pledge."
"I see," said Mr. Dumphy, with a short laugh.
"Excuse me, if I venture to require another condition, merely as a form among men of honor."
"Write as I dictate."
Mr. Dumphy took up a pen. Colonel Starbottle placed one hand on his honorable breast and began slowly and meditatively to pace the length of the room with the air of a second measuring the distance for his principal.
"Are you ready?"
"Go on," said Dumphy, impatiently. "I hereby pledge myself that in the event of any disclosure by me of confidential communications from Colonel Starbottle to me, I shall hold myself ready to afford him the usual honorable satisfaction common among gentlemen, at such times or places, and with such weapons as he may choose, without further formality of challenge, and that failing in that, I do thereby proclaim myself, without posting, a liar, poltroon, and dastard." In the full preoccupation of his dignified composition, and possibly from an inability to look down over the increased exaggeration of his swelling breast, Colonel Starbottle did not observe the contemptuous smile which curled the lip of his amanuensis. Howbeit, Mr. Dumphy signed the document and handed it to him. Colonel Starbottle put it in his pocket. Nevertheless, he lingered by Mr. Dumphy's side. "The check," said the colonel, with a slight cough, "had better be to your order, endorsed by you to spare any criticism hereafter." Mr. Dumphy hesitated a moment. He would have preferred, as a matter of business, to have first known the contents of the envelope, but with a slight smile he dashed off the check and handed it to the colonel. "If it would not be too much trouble," said the colonel, jauntily, "for the same reason just mentioned, would you give that piece of paper to one of your clerks to draw the money for me?" Mr. Dumphy impatiently, with his eyes on the envelope, rang his bell and handed the check to the clerk, while Colonel Starbottle, with an air of abstraction, walked discreetly to the window. For the rest of Colonel Starbottle's life he never ceased to deplore this last act of caution, and regret that he had not put the check in his pocket. For as he walked to the window, the floor suddenly appeared to rise beneath his feet and as suddenly sank again, and he was thrown violently against the mantelpiece. He felt sick and giddy. With a terrible apprehension of apoplexy in his whirling brain, he turned toward his companion, who had risen from his seat and was supporting himself by his swinging desk with a panic-stricken face and a pallor equal to his own. In another moment a bookcase toppled with a crash to the floor, a loud outcry arose from the outer offices, and amidst the sounds of rushing feet, the breaking of glass, and the creaking of timber, the two men dashed with a common instinct to the door. It opened 2 inches and remained fixed. With the howl of a caged wild beast, Dumphy threw himself against the rattling glass of the window that opened on the level of the street. In another instant Colonel Starbottle was beside him on the sidewalk, and the next they were separated, unconsciously, uncaringly, as if they had been the merest strangers in contact in a crowd. The business that had brought them together, the unfinished, incomplete, absorbing interests of a moment ago, were forgotten, were buried in the oblivion of another existence, which had no sympathy with this, whose only instinct was to fly where, they knew not. The middle of the broad street was filled with a crowd of breathless, pallid, death-stricken men who had lost all sense but the common instinct of animals. There were hysterical men, who laughed loudly without a cause, and talked incessantly of what they knew not. There were dumb, paralyzed men, who stood helplessly and hopelessly beneath cornices and chimneys that toppled over and crushed them. There were automatic men, who flying, carried with them the work on which they were engaged, one whose hands were full of bills and papers, another who held his ledger under his arm. There were men who had forgotten the ordinary instincts of decency, some half-dressed. There were men who rushed from the fear of death into its presence, Two were picked up, one who had jumped through a skylight, another who had blindly leaped from a fourth-story window. There were brave men who trembled like children, there was one whose life had been spent in scenes of daring and danger, who cowered paralyzed in the corner of the room from which a few inches of plastering had fallen. There were hopeful men who believed that the danger was over, and having passed, would, by some mysterious law, never recur. There were others who shook their heads and said that the next shock would be fatal. There were crowds around the dust that arose from fallen chimneys and cornices, around runaway horses that had dashed as madly as their drivers against lamp posts, around telegraph and newspaper offices eager to know the extent of the disaster. Along the remoter avenues and cross streets, dwellings were deserted, people sat upon their doorsteps or in chairs upon the sidewalks, fearful of the houses they had built with their own hands, and doubtful even of this blue arch above them that smiled so deceitfully, of those far-reaching fields beyond, which they had cut into lots and bartered and sold, and which now seemed to suddenly rise against them, or slip and wither away from their very feet. It seemed so outrageous that this dull, patient earth, whose homeliness they had adorned and improved, and which, whatever their other fortune or vicissitudes, at least had been their sure inheritance, should have become so faithless. Small wonder that the owner of a little house, which had sunk on the reclaimed waterfront, stooped in the speechless and solemn absurdity of his wrath to shake his clenched fist in the face of the great mother. The real damage to life and property had been so slight and in such pronounced contrast to the prevailing terror, that half an hour later only a sense of the ludicrous remained with the greater masses of the people. Mr. Dumphy, like all practical, unimaginative men, was among the first to recover his presence of mind with the passing of the immediate danger. People took confidence when this great man, who had so much to lose, after sharply remanding his clerks and everybody else back to business, re-entered his office. He strode at once to his desk. But the envelope was gone. He looked hurriedly among his papers on the floor by the broken window, but in vain. Mr. Dumphy instantly rang his bell. The clerk appeared. Was that draft paid?
No, sir, we were counting the money when.
Stop it, return the draft to me. The young man was confiding to his confreres his suspicions of a probable run on the bank as indicated by Mr. Dumphy's caution, when he was again summoned by Mr. Dumphy. Go to Mr. Poinsett's office and ask him to come here at once. In a few moments the clerk returned out of breath. Mr. Poinsett left a quarter of an hour ago, sir, for San Antonio.
San Antonio?
Yes, sir, they say there's bad news from the mission.